So the next thing we did to increase the speed of the site was we added another database. And this was using a piece of software called Slony, I believe, to replicate our database. We still only had one app server at this time, and we made lots of database requests. Our caching wasn't nearly as advanced. We had some basic caching. It was just at the application level. This machine was hitting both of these Postgres machines. This is the first time we ran into the notion of replication lag, because we had these two separate machines, and Slony would normally keep them in sync, but sometimes the slave machine could lag by about 5 seconds or so. And if you had just submitted a link, and then we'd redirect you to the permalink, and then we'd hit the slave machine that didn't have the permalink, we'd send the user a 404, which is really annoying right after you submitted a piece of content. That's when we started thinking about keeping our cache, writing to our cache at the same time as writing to our database. And we also had the issue with these two processes of keeping these caches in sync. We weren't using Memcached yet. The way we kept our caches in sync was we used a library called Spread. And Spread is this kind of network library that basically you say, if you send a message to one host, it'll send it to all these other hosts. And so around this time is when we added our second app server that was running Python on it as well. And we used Spread to keep the two hash tables that we were using as our cache kind of in sync. This worked sort of okay in terms of keeping these two caches in sync, but it wasn't going to scale very well because eventually we would add a couple more app servers to deal with more load. And Spread, like every time one of these app servers would update its cache, it would have to tell all of the other app servers about it. And so it turned into this huge mess, a lot of network traffic keeping all of these caches in sync. It was a total mess. And so eventually we would switch to Memcached, but that was not before we rewrote our database. Shortly after we switched to a couple machines and a couple databases, we added comments. And the first version of comments, it was just another database table. There was nothing complicated about it. It had a link ID of what link it was on, and it had, you know, some contents, author ID. You can kind of guess the columns it would have, and we still did lots of joins. It was a relational database. We changed around this time to a more flexible database architecture, or at least a more flexible table design. Because the challenge we had was every time we added a new feature, we might have to add a new table, or we might add a new column to one of these tables. Adding a column would take time. And two, we might have to do a data migration or update an index and then add all this load. And it was just a total pain. We felt like the rate at which we could add features was limited by our ability to update our database and to do these big migrations.